TV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.
Hi, my name is Amy Malecki. I am the market leader for Manpower in the southeastern Pennsylvania market. I joined SHRM about 2 years ago. I had just recently moved to the area. I needed to make community connections. I wanted to meet new people. So I thought SHRM would be a great opportunity. It has been. The benefits and advantages that I've received from my membership have just been meeting, you know, tons of people, communicating with them, coming to the meetings, always full of energy, great information that we can take back as HR professionals and I can use every day while I'm supporting workforce development and retention at Manpower. So that to me is what SHRM is all about, just that community engagement, giving people the opportunity to build positive relationships, collaborate, develop strategic partnerships to enhance their career and development.
Good evening. My name is Bob Orzechowski. I'm Chief Operating Officer for a cancer center. And we welcome you tonight to the 87th program, our 14th year on BCTV, Human Resource Management. Exciting topic tonight, the wage and hour laws in the state and federal arenas. But before we get started, I'd like to introduce our august panel tonight. To my far left is Susanna Fultz. She's an attorney with the law firm of Lizowitz Heller. Susanna has both business and individual clients for them. She has her JD degree from Washington and Lee University School of Law in Virginia and a BA cum laude from University of Delaware. She's admitted to the bar for the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania, the U.S. District Court, the Eastern District of Pennsylvania, and the Supreme Court of the United States. She has a concentration in employment law, commercial litigation, and she's a member of the Berks County Bar, president of the Young Lawyer section, and numerous other professional associations. Welcome, Susanna.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And to my immediate left, we have Kamila DeAngelis. I've been corrected. I've been saying it wrong for years, apparently. She has about 7 years in HR, 3 years with our chapter. She's also certified in the Society for Human Resource Management, which we'll talk about a little bit later. She's a human resource manager at EasyPack, which is a production company off Route 61, I believe. She's also a graduate of the Leadership Berks program. So welcome back, Kamila. You've been here before.
Thank you for having me.
Knows the routine. We'd also like to thank our underwriter, Chip Mosteller, and the company Mosteller & Associates. They're a full-service human resource consulting firm, they assist organizations of all sizes with HR needs. They're out on Morgantown Road, and you can reach them at 610-779-3870 or www.mostellerhr.com. Their information will be up at the bottom of the program as well. It's on your screen now. The program tonight, as I said, wage and hour laws update. There's a lot happening in that field, we're going to go over some of the more substantive issues. Disclaimer, certainly nothing here is meant to be legal advice, and the opinions of the panelists are their own and not necessarily those of their employers or of BCTV. Speaking of BCTV, we have to take a moment to recognize the power that this organization brings to our community. It serves to enhance the unity and strength of our community. If you've ever looked online to see bctv.org, if you've ever looked online to see the vast array of programming that they have, there's literally something for everyone. And even the live shows are rebroadcast throughout the week. So no matter what shift you're working, you can catch your favorite shows, be it for music, entertainment, politics, social issues, government, our professional issues here, other business-related programs. There's something for everyone. We are streaming online at bctv.org, so we're international now. And this particular program is replayed Fridays at 8 p.m., Saturdays at 1 p.m., and Wednesdays at 9 a.m. And we move on with our thanks and recognition to the International Society of Human Resource Management, SHRM, as we like to call it affectionately, or SHRM. It's got about 200,000 members. We're in about 50 countries. It's devoted to the professional development of human resource managers, and other persons with different interests in the HR field. And they're involved in some advocacy, certainly professional development. And I would encourage you to look at shrm.org for better information on that. As far as the Berks County chapter, I'll turn that over for a moment here to Kamila, and she can give you a little update on what's happening locally.
I think I can't emphasize enough that our local chapter has been very active in the Berks County and our community here. I've been the member for the last 3 years, and from learning a lot about local businesses and what they bring to our employers, to HR community, I have received my SHRM certificate through the prep courses that, Bob, you are leading, which are fantastic. But I can emphasize the fact that as a Silver Excel Chapter Award that our Berks chapter won, this is the second highest award given by SHRM organization. I think it says how the quality of services that our chapter provides, and for networking, for learning, workforce development, for professional development. The topics that are being presented every month are great and very diverse depending on our interests and what's new, what's trendy, from updates on laws to issues that HR representatives are dealing every single day. So I would definitely encourage everyone who is in HR field, who has not registered or to participate in Berks chapter, to do so, because it's the benefits are plentiful.
Great, thank you very much, Kamila. There's, you know, you don't have to have HR in your title to be a member of SHRM or to be a member of our local chapter. Many small businesses out there aren't large enough to justify the cost of a full-time HR person, so it might fall to a plant manager, an office manager, maybe a regional person that travels around, but you still have HR responsibilities and obligations and compliance issues no matter how small or how large you are. And we certainly encourage you at the bottom of the program, you'll see some information on how to reach us. Our administrative director, Wendy, is happy to chat with anybody. You can see us online at www.berkspa.sherm.org. That information will be up for you later if you are interested to check us out. We do meet the second Tuesday of every month for breakfast, and the meeting's about an hour and a half. There's practice business. There's committee reports, and we always have a speaker from 8 to 9 a.m. Today we had our speaker on the website, your company website, and is it ADA compliant, which is frankly something that a lot of people don't even think about, but there's an ADA issue there lurking in the background. But tonight we're going to jump right into this program. The wage and hour laws, technically, it's the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938, and it was the nation's first attempt at a national job classification scheme. Almost immediately, they had to develop exemptions and exclusions, whole industries, fishing, mining, agriculture, rather, and they realized they had to exempt from the coverage of the law executives, professionals of some sort or another. And it's been changed over the years, and it's something with which Susanna can bring us up to date in just a moment. Covers interstate commerce. Pennsylvania has a comparable law, a little bit different, and again, Susanna will fill us in on that as well. It touches on record keeping, hours of work, pay periods, and if you contact the Wage and Hour Division of the U.S. Department of Labor, they will give you this little brochure that has about 18 different issues within the law that are something to be mindful of, no matter what size employer you are. Susanna, I guess, could we start out with who is an employee versus, we've seen a lot in the law about independent contractors. So it covers employees, but it doesn't cover independent contractors.
Correct. So as an employer, you have somebody to come to, that comes to work for you. You can't just assume that they're employee versus independent contractor. There are certain tax implications, benefits implications. The IRS has a test that you should follow or have an attorney help kind of do an audit for you if you're not sure if the person falls into an independent contractor or an employee status. The government looks at things like, does the worker control their hours? Do they control when they come in, how they do the job? Do you have a certain task, or and how are they performing that task? Are they using their own tools? It might seem attractive to you to want to classify somebody as an independent contractor to perhaps save money on benefits and things like that. But just calling somebody an independent contractor doesn't mean that they are an independent contractor. And if there's a misclassification, you could be subject to all kinds of financial penalties. And that status, as Bob said, affects which federal and state laws apply in terms of wage payment and other perks of employment, so to speak. So you want to be really careful when you're talking about employees versus independent contractors. And an area that this comes up a lot in that I've seen recently is construction workers. There's a specific act in Pennsylvania, Act 72, the Construction Workplace Misclassification Act. If you're an employer and you're in the construction business, a lot of times you have subcontractors that you might work with, and you have to be very careful when you're classifying them as independent contractors. The Act 72 has very specific requirements. I won't get into them right now for the sake of time, but you need to be very careful in terms of the independent contractor having liability insurance, having a written contract for them. There's very specific rules you need to follow. So I encourage you, if you're in the construction industry, to definitely take notice of that, because that all relates back to wage payment and unemployment compensation and workers' compensation insurance that you need per the law in Pennsylvania.
Well, as far as we used to know the words about a W-2 employee and all the payroll taxes are taken out and whatever, but with the gig economies, it can be very seductive for employers to bring people on in certain capacities without going through that IRS checklist. And if you get onto the IRS, they do have a checklist that you can look up as well to help guide you. But yeah, it is a potential trap. Susanna, also with the Fair Labor Standards Act, you can imagine in 1938, there were sweatshops, there were no child labor laws, there were no safety issues, nobody kept records and timekeeping. It was a pretty brutal place in America to work, I imagine, which is why this law came about. And what are some of the, for instance, the difference between a work week and a pay period?
So you and I might think of a work week as 5 days. Some employers choose to do pay periods of, I typically see 2 weeks, 2 week pay periods. And how the pay period is defined can also affect how you calculate overtime, which I'm sure we'll discuss in detail later. That's a big problem area for a lot of employers as well. And then Pennsylvania also has the wage payment collection law, which specifies at what point wages basically are due and owed to employees, and that to be paid by a certain time at certain pay periods as per if you have a contract, or most people are at will. So usually the HR manual or something like that will state when the pay periods happen, when employees can expect to be paid.
Well, we are certainly going to touch on the contents of an HR manual or policy book or anything for the employers out there. And we are live tonight, 610-378-0426. For you home viewers with questions, comments, and general complaints, we invite your call in. It is on a 5-second delay, so please turn down your television if you do call in. So, but the Fair Labor Standards Act, federal, obviously that's interstate commerce. Is every employer in Berks County covered by it or a comparable state law?
A lot of the federal laws, it depends how many employees you have. And like you said, there's a lot of exemptions too for certain industries. So like FLSA, for example, I want to say like newspaper delivery people aren't under like the Minimum Wage Act as far as that's concerned with the federal and the state minimum wage. So you can't say blanket, it applies to all employers at all times because it really depends nature of your business, number of employees you have.
Okay, and even then, maybe whole industries, maybe farming or fishing or something.
Yeah, agricultural workers aren't
so,
in there.
So one of the takeaways from tonight's program is retain legal counsel and figure out if what laws cover you, and because this is certainly one law you don't want to run afoul of. It'll make the newspaper, and that won't be good for anybody. What about record keeping? What kind of records do we have to keep? And maybe how long do we have to keep them relative to payroll and, I guess, wages and hours?
Well, certainly when you're talking about non-exempt or what most people would consider if you're paid hourly, you have to keep track of your employees' hourly work. It doesn't really specify there's nothing to say you can't use a time clock, or a lot of people have computer software for the employees clock in and out, write it down on a piece of paper, but you have to keep records of that because you have to make sure that you're compliant, that if that employee, that are getting paid for the hours worked, and if they're working over 40 hours a week, and we'll discuss more later, if they're making under a certain annual salary per year, then they're entitled to overtime above the 40 hours they work at 1.5 times their normal compensation. So it's very important to keep records that way, especially if you're subject to an audit from either the federal government or Pennsylvania Department of Labor. You want to be able to show, and it's actually a good idea to kind of self-audit as you go. So you want to make sure that you're paying employees proper wages for the hours that they work. So that's what I think is one of the most important record-keeping activities you as an employer need to do to make sure that your employees are being properly paid and that you're following all the regulations.
Well, that's certainly a critical piece of this law's compliance issues. And we will get into the exemptions in just a moment. And the Pennsylvania law then has exemptions as well. And they used to be the same, now they're not. But Kamila, I was going to ask you, the process you've gone through, if you have independent contractors versus employees, and the process you've gone through, and also we were talking before the show about interns and how you're handling that, because I know a couple years ago interns and internships were in the news, and they were going to have to be paid, and I forget who was exactly cracking down on it, but that was big. Can you talk a little bit about those issues?
Certainly, with independent contractors, so we've definitely worked very closely with our council to develop an agreement, and exactly agreement that specifies the duties and responsibilities, just so we are very clear as to where that the line to define between the independent contractor and actually a full-time employee or actual employee of our company. So we were very closely with our counsel, and we did do the IRS checklist to make sure that we are protected and we're following all the guidelines. I think that's very important to know. I think that the most important thing is to identify, do you really need an independent contractor, and what are the task that this person or the company will provide us. So I think that's what we do, number one, and then work with the council to identify that. With the internship, we are developing a program right now to provide paid internships to college students because of the industry we work at. there are age requirements for the safety reasons, so we cannot have anyone on a plant that are 18 years and younger.
On the plant floor.
On right. the plant floor, but for so internships that we're talking about is more like engineering. They're very actively on the plant floor. So mm-hmm. we're developing a program and to make sure we meet all the standards, and we're very clearly defined that in our ever-growing manual to address all that.
Okay, and how do your employees, how do you track employees' time? Time clocks or time cards or computer login? I mean, how are you recording time to know what to pay people?
We do have time clocks, and we do have a software on a computer, so our office employees can clock in that way, and then we have physical clocks, so we do it both ways.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And Susanna, I was going to ask you now, we're at a point where not every employer, not every industry, not every employee is going to be covered by this law. The law provides for the employer to be able to exempt certain people from this law. Mm-hmm. And then having made that exemption, hopefully job descriptions are accurate and records are kept to prove it. Just calling somebody president doesn't mean they're exempt. It's not the title, it's the work. Could you talk a little bit about the exemptions, and then we'll get into the implications of being non-exempt?
Okay, so like again, when we're talking about being exempt and non-exempt, under the guidelines, there are three kind of major positions that they kind of set aside as saying that they're exempt. Professional, I believe it's administrative or secretarial, and the third one doesn't pop into my head right now. But the problem is when people are trying to, as an employer, classify somebody as non-exempt or exempt. We'll discuss the salary threshold later, but there are those specific, kind of there's a job duties test is what it's called. And like Bob said, just calling somebody professional or president or something like that doesn't necessarily mean that you can classify them as exempt or non-exempt. Because if you get it wrong and you put someone as exempt when they should be non-exempt, and you're paying them salary when they should be hourly, and you're not giving them overtime, then you're going to run afoul of FLSA. And the job duties test, it may seem like it's clear cut, but it's not. And there is some guidance from the Department of Labor on specific things like social workers, attorneys, things like that. But it's not always easy. They have, like I said, they have the guidance, and they kind of have those categories that are exempt. But for instance, like professional, you think like corporate president or CEO or something like that. But that category could also apply to an office manager. That's why you have to kind of pick through your job descriptions with a fine-tooth comb to see if somebody is exempt or non-exempt. That's something that I have done in the past for clients, is gone through their job descriptions and try to parse out who really is exempt from who shouldn't be, because that has wide-ranging implications for the employer.
And the issue too, even there's the federal law when it was changed, and by the way, folks, when the minimum wage changes in America, this is the law that's amended for that. It sets also the minimum wage. We didn't really mention that earlier, but it used to be in addition to the ones that Susanna mentioned, outside sales, and with the professional. They also added then, with the latest update a few years ago, was computer professionals. Because up until that point, nobody really knew how to handle them. And my rule's always been, if there's any doubt, you make them non-exempt, make them hourly, and we'll go from there. But the outside sales, there was something in the news a few years ago with pharmaceutical field representatives. As were they outside sales employees, or when they visited hospitals and doctor's offices where they were detailing and sharing information about the manufacturer's products, the drugs, that the hours they were putting in were obviously long hours, traveling hours and whatever. And I believe they litigated that, and I'm trying to remember how it came out that the courts decided that they were in fact outside sales and were in fact exempt, but they really weren't selling anything, which is kind of a strange duck there in that sense. So it is very complicated. There are duties tests, there are salaries tests, but it is not some law that you want to run afoul of. It's very complicated, but know that just because you call somebody an office manager, if their duties are mainly clerical, and maybe they're the office manager because they've been there the longest and they just happen to keep the payroll records for somebody, doesn't make them an office manager. So we're getting back as one of the common themes here that should be a takeaway for you tonight in the audience there is the value of accurate job descriptions. And I know in each of our job descriptions that are exempt, we have an exempt determination sheet, which we kind of modified from the Department of Labor's exemption document. And if we don't have that in there, it's non-exempt. But one of the fallouts of being exempt out of this law is that you must be paid a salary. And we'll get into that in a moment. I want to turn it over to Kamila for a moment because when you're non-exempt then, it means you're not exempt from the law. It means you are covered by the law. And what are the implications there for what are hours worked? Because if it's not hours worked, it doesn't count towards the hours for time and a half.
Correct.
How are you handling that?
You know, it has been definitely a work in progress, and kind of that's how I always like to network with my HR folks in New Berks County, just to see how they handle this particular issue, because I've worked in companies that actually were not. So if you were not working, let's say you were on vacation or it was a holiday, that did calculate towards your overtime, but that was just the goodwill of the company. But then I also work at the businesses that just, you know, you get paid for the hours worked, because that's the law. So if you're not physically providing I'm talking about non-exempt here, hourly employees. If you're not physically performing the job, then you're not eligible for overtime if you work more than 40 hours. And I think that that's what the law is. But I'm also seeing that a lot of employers, a lot of my colleagues, are facing due to this competition in labor and how to attract talent to do and incentivize that. Actually, no, we are going to if it's a scheduled time off or if it's a holiday that company recognizes that they will be paying the time and a half, although you really didn't physically work, but. So I think that's something that is changing, and I'm kind of observing what's happening in this arena. But as of right now, I think that the rule of thumb is if you don't work for a non-hourly, right. For the hourly non-exempt, if you're not physically performing the job, then...
But you are doing something maybe a little more unique as well, we learned... that you have non-exempt people that are in fact paid a salary. That must be a payroll keeping nightmare.
I have a fantastic payroll employee who manages quite, and they still have to clock in and clock out just for the
But the issue the must be, yeah. What's the base rate to determine the time and a half rate?
Correct.
Jeez, yeah. Owie.
But again, I think we're trying to. Our payroll system is quite flexible with everything that we're trying to do. And again, I think with the current state of marketplace, we have to attract the talent. We need to really think of different ways to make sure that we compensate everyone properly, but how we can do it so we attract more talent.
Well, the first rule of recruiting is keep the ones you have, I suppose.
That's correct.
We are halfway through the program, and we have another one of those testimonials keyed up, I believe.
Hi, I'm Christy. I'm a local business owner and bilingual HR professional. SHRM has been a great resource for me. The meetings are always very informative, and there's always hot coffee, breakfast, and HR credits. SHRM's a way for local HR professionals and national members to stay on top of laws and regulations while also getting to connect with other business owners and HR professionals. Through SHRM, I actually obtained my HR certifications, and I've been able to get more involved at the committee level, which has allowed me to greater impact our local community. Even more importantly, I've been able to bring back important information into our business to help reduce our risks and improve our overall business in order to grow and evolve in today's market.
Well, we are back. We're live tonight, Tuesday, and it's January 14th, 6:31 p.m. We are live tonight, 610-378-0426 for you home viewers. We'd love to have you call in with your questions and comments. It's a very complicated law we're trying to deal with in an hour. We just finished with a bit of the background on it. We haven't really gotten to determining what a regular rate of pay is for a non-exempt employee. We haven't gotten into much of the exemptions, the exempt employees. Not as critical there. Timekeeping. But when we talk about timekeeping, we have to talk first about what are working hours. Suppose you have to punch in at the gate, and then you have to walk through the parking lot, walk through the factory, put on welding equipment, like when I welded at Dana. And is this all paid time, or is this time that you have to give to the company just for the privilege of working there? And for the subject of working hours, I want to turn it back over to Susanna again for a few comments.
So this is interesting. A lot of people have questions about what is and what is not compensable time. Obviously, people don't get paid to commute to work, even though they wish they could, especially if you live far away. But one of the issues that's actually recently come up in Pennsylvania that is currently before the Pennsylvania Supreme Court is whether employees should be paid while they are showing up to their job, and this is at an Amazon warehouse, they have to go through screening before they come in and when they leave, for whatever purpose that is. But Amazon doesn't want to pay these people for their time, and the workers sue because they feel like that they should be compensated for the time it takes when they show up on the job site to go through the screening. And a similar subject is if your job requires you to wear protective clothing. If you work in like a industrial environment and you're required to what's called don and doff protective gear, you have to be really careful about, you know, if you're requiring your employees to wear that, you should probably be paying them for when they're taking their gear on and off, especially if it's on company property and if you're providing them locker space to do that. Some unions may have different things in their bargaining agreements for that specific activity, but if you're just a general employer without a union shop, you should be very careful about what you're paying and not paying people for, especially if you're requiring them to attend certain safety meetings or whatnot. I'm not saying it's all compensable or it's not. You just need to be very careful as to what you have to compensate your employees for their time.
We've seen it in maybe the more office setting as well, but we want to get into the subject of breaks. And are they mandatory in Pennsylvania? Does this law mandate them other than maybe the nursing mother law? But there are a number of issues around in the office environment. You might have the receptionist that is ordered to take her lunch at her desk or his desk so that the reception activity continues. That's working time just because it's 12 to 1 p.m. doesn't mean if you're forcing them to work, that's working time. And we see sometimes that is a stumbling block for employees. But does the Fair Labor Standards Act or the Pennsylvania statute address mandatory breaks? I guess child labor, maybe 14 years or whatever, sure. But is that on the books?
So like you said, if you're requiring somebody to sit at their desk and continue working, you should be paying them for that. That's not a true lunch break for them. You don't, if somebody's taking a lunch break and they're going to lunch, leaving the building or doing whatever they're doing on their own time, you don't have to pay them for that time. And a lot of people misunderstand or are confused about things like breaks and vacation and sick days and think that they're owed certain things. And actually, like, there is no law in Pennsylvania that says an employer has to give you vacation days. So a lot of people, you know, think that they're entitled to certain things. And I'd say, as from the employee perspective, kind of switching gears, you know, when you start your job, if your employer has a manual, make sure you read through it and see what they're offering you. Because you shouldn't just walk in the door and assume you're entitled to 3 weeks vacation, because under the law, they don't have to give you any vacation. So that's just something to keep in mind as an employee in terms of what the terms and conditions of your employment is.
Okay. The another issue that, because despite 65 degree weather a few days ago, it's winter, we're at 40 degrees north latitude, it's going to snow. And or ice, and maybe even have ice tomorrow morning the way it looks. But where does inclement weather come into all of this? The non-exempt workers, the hourly workers in most cases, show up for work, or they can't get to work, or they show up and the employer shuts down after a while because it's just too bad out there. How's that handled?
So if you're a salaried employee and say your office closes one day of the week, if you work that week, you're fine. You're still going to get paid. You should still get paid by your employer. If you're hourly, technically you only get paid for the hours that you work. So as the employer, if you're closing the office, that person isn't coming to work. They're not going to get paid. But if you want to be nice, I know a lot of employers will allow, especially if the office is open and the employee doesn't feel safe coming to work, they're not able to get out of their house. Like for me, I live up on a mountain. It's colder, it's icier up there. I think it's what a lot of employers do is they allow their employees to use if they have sick time or vacation time. Mm-hmm. So that way they're still getting paid. They're not missing that payment. It's obviously up to the employer in terms of if you still want to pay your employees when you're closed, you absolutely can. I mean, it's a nice gesture. A lot of people are counting on, you know, that paycheck and that it's not really their fault that it snowed.
So, Kamila, how do you handle inclement weather at your place?
So I think very similarly to what Susanna just provided us, but we also add an option that if employee non-exempt employee, hourly employees don't want to, some of them say, well, I already have my vacation planned, or I don't want to use that, that they can just take it without pay. And obviously without no consequences or discipline. So I think that's, we're adding that. So you can, you don't have to. Thankfully, we really haven't closed up much or often. I haven't heard about any inclement weather event that actually happened at the facility, so that's good. But as of right now, and again, to your point, we are very clear about providing our employees all the information, our manual, so they understand what happens and there are no surprises. I think communication is a key too.
Absolutely. It's now, you only have one site locally,
so
employees come to that site and then they go home. Sometimes you will send non-exempt people to meetings, maybe overnight, maybe not. So pay during travel time for non-exempt can be a little tricky, and I'd be interested to hear how that's handled. Exempt people traveling, doesn't matter. You know, they're going to get paid their salary. How does it work for non-exempt employees who travel?
Actually, in our currently, and well, we do not have non-exempt employees that travel.
Okay.
We have mostly our exempt employees that travel between facilities because we have a few locations throughout the states, United States. So thankfully, we don't have that happen. If it's going to happen, we talked about that before the show, that I definitely looking for to work with my counsel, my advisor, to develop very strict guidelines, so I know that we are following the right directions and the guidelines.
Well, Susanna, then let me pose a few things that I know have occurred locally. There are some places that do have non-exempt people traveling, and it's business. Maybe they're field technicians or something. We also have situations in this county where even throughout the county, there are multiple sites. And the employee may have to show up at site A for the morning and then travel to site B for the afternoon and then travel home from site B. Are any of those things compensable? How are they handled?
I believe that if you're, so obviously we kind of talked about if you're just your regular commute, you're not going to get paid for that. But if you're traveling like in a company vehicle or your boss says, I need you to go to this place to meet this person on company business, you should be paying the employee for traveling from the office to X or Y. If you have the multi-site scenario that you described before, in terms of them going from that site back home, I think you can subtract the difference between their normal commute time from that, but you still, whatever the difference is, you still have to pay them for that travel.
So do the math.
Right.
And none of this should be a surprise to an employee. To Camilla's point about communication, these are the kind of things that need to be in manuals and policy procedures because the last thing you want to do, folks, is run afoul of this law. We did want to get into the new law that's come out from, well, not a law, a regulation that's come out from the Department of Labor. I imagine it's a regulation, not a law, but have they officially amended the Fair Labor Standards Act with their new regular rate descriptions?
So the Department of Labor issued a final rulemaking which became effective January 1st, 2020. Raising the salary threshold for that non-exempt exempt test we talked about under the Fair Labor Standards Act.
Right.
So it basically says if you are making less than $35,568 per year, you should be getting, and you have to do the job duties test on top of that.
It's both duties and wages. Mm-hmm.
Then if you're non-exempt and you make less than that, then you should be getting paid overtime. And that's what the basic change of that rule was. It kind of upped the salary threshold. So more people are eligible for overtime now.
If they're earning less than that. And that's, if you do the math, folks, divide that by 2,080 hours for a work year, it's about $17.10. So you would think that most anyone in a position that would qualify as exempt, executive, outside sales, professional, computer workers, are already earning at least $17.10. So, but it's to be noted that with employers, if you have not listed all your workers categorized by exempt, non-exempt, and looked at their wages, you might have a few people that are on the borderline there, and you've got a decision to make. It's either make them non-exempt and, in most cases, pay them an hourly rate now, or nudge them a bit in their salary so that they do hit the salary threshold if the duties are in fact legitimately exempt. That's kind of the decision tree that employers are looking for, are looking at. And if you haven't done that regular rate audit yet, because there's so many other, it's total compensation divided by total hours worked, basically. But the regulations have about 20 exemptions to it that don't count as money. And so it could force employers to really look at the value of their benefits, for instance. And if there's cash benefits in there as opposed to unpaid time off, which is for a lot of people, they'd rather have the time than the money. And so the employers out there are put on notice that as of January 1st, you have a little bit more work to do to stay in compliance with the Fair Labor Standards Act. We were talking earlier, you had mentioned, Susanna, about was there another we're getting to Pennsylvania a little bit here with some of the differences. What are the more noticeable differences, either court cases or statutes, with the Fair Labor Standards Act, the Pennsylvania's Small Business Minimum Wage Act, or what's the official title of it?
Yeah, Pennsylvania has what's called the Pennsylvania Minimum Wage Act, which some parts of it are similar to the Fair Labor Standards Act. In Pennsylvania, though, generally if you're an employer and you're looking at your duties under the Pennsylvania law versus the federal law, I think just a really good general point to make is that you should follow whichever is the most generous to your employees. So sometimes state law is more generous than federal law or vice versa. But specifically in Pennsylvania, you want to make sure that you're following whichever is the most generous. And I think that's in terms of just a global statement in terms of the differences there. So, and in Pennsylvania, if you're an employer, Pennsylvania hasn't strictly adopted all the FLSA, so a court interpreting Pennsylvania state law is going to be looking at the Pennsylvania Minimum Wage Act. But like I said before, if whichever is more generous to the employees, definitely follow that path in terms of any differences.
With the and the state and federal minimum wage, though, are both $7.25 an hour.
Correct.
And certainly there are still people out there, workers who are earning that, and it is I'm sure an economic challenge, but it's also got to be an economic challenge for the employer, because if that gets raised artificially, now the employer has pay compression issues. If they're trying to keep pay differentials between supervised and supervisor, what do they do there? There's also going to be some impact on workers' comp insurance policies, because that's payroll-based, and certainly retirement plans. So there's a lot of ripple effects to this besides just the absolute wage that I think employers need to, and maybe regulators need to be mindful of. But something we haven't touched on yet is the Equal Pay Act, and or any pay-related challenges that would involve compliance with this law. Are there any out there that are floating around that you know about that we area employers ought to be mindful of?
I think in terms of actually, you know, Pennsylvania has the Equal Pay Act in terms of not discriminating in terms of pay based on sex. I think generally a lot of things I'm seeing employers run into now, kind of salary-wise, is during the application process when people are coming in and you're interviewing them. Philadelphia, for instance, recently passed an ordinance that affects city employers that you're not allowed to ask prior salary history as part of the application process. They were sued based on the Philadelphia Chamber of Commerce said that restricted their First Amendment right to free speech in terms of being able to ask employers that. So now it's up in the air, it's in front of the Third Circuit. So I would say a lot of times, even if something's not a law, as an employer, maybe you want to play it safe and not ask people salary history. And also Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, and statewide in terms of state agencies, you're not allowed to ask criminal history right off the bat anymore. It's called ban the box. There's no statewide prohibition on doing that, but certain cities and actually certain counties in Pennsylvania have actually gone ahead and done this.
Well, now with the argument about the free speech rights, is it the employer is saying, I have First Amendment rights to be able to ask about a salary? I thought in the private sector, you didn't really have constitutional protection.
Right. So I'm not intimately familiar with this case. From what I understand is they said that you're allowed in Philadelphia, this is still in contention right now, you're allowed to ask the salary, but you can't rely upon it to make an appointment decision.
Right.
So that's where it stands right now. before it was just a ban. You can't ask at all. You can't ask.
And it's, I can imagine too, though, with and I'll ask Kamila here how they're handling things like that too, because what you were paid in your previous job, I've got a pay plan. I have a salary range. I have to slot you anyway where I have current people already doing that job, doing it well. I certainly can't hire you at more than they're making. What are they going to think of me when that gets out? Because you can't forbid conversation about pay, I believe.
That's correct. The National Labor Relations Act and the Labor Relations Board come down hard on people, especially like if, for instance, if you have a in your company manual that it says you can't discuss certain things online. They've coming down hard on people, even for generic things like be courteous and respectful on social media.
Yes, civility laws.
Right. So, but if you're discussing like your pay rate and work conditions on social media, you can't get fired for that. It's a violation.
Section 7. Yeah.
Yeah. So good heavens. You have to be careful.
Well, we're just about getting through this, but with your Kamila, when you hire people, how do you make sure that your offer is competitive enough, and yet the offer is going to fit and not upset your totem pole of pays and performance with you already have in a competitive market like today is. The market's moving faster than companies' internal abilities to move pay. How are you handling that?
I think that it's a challenge for all of the employers. Just because, to your point, by the time you establish a pay or pay scale, that's already obsolete because the market moves so fast. But what we have recently done is completed a comprehensive salary. Salary range project that a third party helped us assess that will help us guide to be competitive, to be to provide the right compensation, and so that's kind of where we are standing right now because of the market. Yeah.
Well, I guess one of the last things to mention here before we move to close is. The IRS blessed us with a new W-4 form, and you're almost going to have to give it to employees to take to an accountant or somebody to fill out anymore because of the tax law changes last year in the new form. Have you, because you had to start using that 2 weeks ago, so have you had any issues with any employees coming to you with a head scratcher on that one?
Certainly, and they ask us for advice, and obviously we're not... I cannot provide with the advice as to how to complete the W-4. You know, I'm trying to provide them with the resources where to go and how to.
Well, what are those resources? Tell us all.
Not even resources. To your point is, you know, I always say, please speak to your tax advisor or. But I always say, you know, internet could be something very powerful for positive and negative.
Will the IRS help them with this?
No.
No.
Unfortunately, so we will. I think it's more to come, but I've had one case where I really couldn't help an individual to how to properly complete it.
Well, and Susanna, what do you have any exposure to the new W-4 form yet yourself?
No, I haven't seen it. From what I understand, obviously, if you're a new employee hired now, you're going to have to fill it out.
Right.
But if you're someone like me and you've been working somewhere for several years, you can keep using whatever old one you have unless you want or need to make a change.
Current employees don't need to fill out a new one.
Correct.
They can, but they don't have to. Well, in the time we have left, I certainly want to thank Chet Mosteller, our underwriter at Mosteller Associates. They're a full-service human resource consulting firm. And they're out there on Morgantown Road, and their information will be on the screen at the bottom of the program. Certainly want to thank our panel tonight, Susanna Fultz here from the law firm of Lizowitz Heller and Why I'm Missing, and Kamila DeAngelis, now you're a real veteran, and with an HR manager with EasyPack Company. And we have our next show Tuesday, March 10th. We're going to focus on the employee benefits component of the wage and effort bargain. So with all of that, we want to say good night, be safe, and we'll see you in March. Thank you.
My name is Audra. I'm a director of human resources with a local manufacturing company.
I joined the Schermbergs chapter in 2000. Since then, I have taken the certification class and earned my SCP, which is a senior certified professional, through Sherm National. Additionally, I have served as a board member, going through as secretary, treasurer, vice president, and eventually president of the Sherm board. I have met many friends, colleagues, and associates who have assisted and guided me in my development as an HR professional. Joining Sherm adds value and recognition to your title as an HR person, and I strongly recommend joining our Schermbergs chapter.
Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.